Hello students, in our previous classes we have seen about the life and history of Shakespeare and Shakespeare's comedies and Shakespeare's tragedies. Now we are going to see in this video Shakespeare's history plays and his use of the soliloquies and his usage of the supernatural events in his dramas. First let us see the historical plays and the events taken place in the historical place. Historical drama is history dramatized. According to Lessing, historical drama is a creation of fiction moved around the historical characters. But Lessing's definition of historical play cannot be applied in the case of Shakespeare's historical plays. Though Shakespeare allows his artistic inventiveness to play upon the works of the history, yet he doesn't consciously tamper with the facts of history except in respect of certain major points. The historical plays of Shakespeare covering a wide period are a faithful chronicle of English history, and they truly represent the long history of England covering over period of about 350 years. The historical plays of Shakespeare present the history of England from 1200 to 1550. Nearly 350 of years English ruin, their tumult and confusion, their peace and conflict are treated in the historical dramas. In all, Shakespeare wrote 10 history plays. They are divided into three groups. Three plays are devoted to the ruin of Henry VI. Secondly, three plays such as Richard II, Richard III and King John bring before us studies in kingship. Thirdly, plays, namely the two parts of Henry IV and Henry V, pieced together and completely by Fletcher. In these historical plays, not only has the dramatist given us an account of the history of more than 300 years, but he has also provided nice portraits of English kings. According to Dowden, Shakespeare has presented three full-length portraits of English kings. In the characters of Kings John, Richard II and Henry VI, Shakespeare presents the weakness of English kings. Henry IV, Henry V, Henry III are studies of kingly strength. The historical plays of Shakespeare are a link between the process of his development of comedies and tragedies. In between the period of tragedies and comedies come the historical plays, and these plays serve their own purpose. The one great object of the historical plays was to make Englishmen more patriotic, to make Englishmen proud of being Englishmen. In these plays, the fire of patriotism burns brightly. Shakespeare's historical plays provide a vigorous pale for national unity. This was indeed the greatest need of the hour in England. Shakespeare's purpose in writing the historical plays was also artistic. The burden of historical plays is not the baffling problem of life and death, nor do they create a final impression of perfect joy and grief. Each historical play of Shakespeare conveys a moral lesson. We see unfolded before us in their working the higher forces of moral retribution under which nemesis dogged the heels of those shellfish kings who made their country welter and swim in blood. The motto of each historical play is very clear. The motto of Richard II may be taken to be whatsoever a man soweth, that shall be also reaped. His other historical plays, Henry the Sixth, Henry the Third, Henry the Fourth, and Henry the Fifth, are studies of practical success and failure, and each play embodies of a moral. In fact, these historical plays are the revenges of time in history. Evil in the historical plays is wrongdoing, which is followed by inevitable retribution. These plays leave a powerful impression of kindly glory, kingly responsibility. Through the long historical succession, we find kingship presented as fraught with temptation, dangers, insecurity, wrongly and rightly possessed. These plays leave a powerful impression of kindly glory, kingly responsibility. Through the long historical succession, we find kingship presented as fraught with temptation, dangers, insecurity, wrongly and rightly possessed, sometimes strongly idealist to divine proportions. The idea of soldiership and horseman is also vividly idealist in the historical plays of Shakespeare. Warship, warriorship, honor, worldly glory were the ideas for which Shakespeare worked in his historical plays. In this historical plays, it is also recognized that there religious facts, duties to which the clangor of warring strokes align and abhorrent. Here bishops and archbishops join in state intrigues, often plot rebellion or urge the kings of wars. The divine interheads the earthly, plays in the king. The earthly becomes all but divine. In King John, the contrast of church and state is developed in detail. In these plays, all kinds of womanhood have been beautifully drawn. We have idealized pictures of motherhood, wifehood, and maidhood. The last question that comes before us in whether Shakespeare has presented historical truth in his histories. It must be borne in mind that a writer of historical plays, under no compulsion to chronicle the facts of history with absolute fidelity without an admixture of his imagination. Historical truth or absolute fidelity to the historical facts must not be looked on all occasions or in all minute details. There is a kind of truth which is sometime higher than truth to facts, and such is Shakespeare's. His histories are always true to the spirit of the age, even when they are not always true in details. When the poet does is to give the true history meaning to the leading moments in the life and progress of the English nation. From the time of John almost to his own time, Moreover, his method is original in his historical place. From the crude and undigested annals which he had at his command, Shakespeare has created and given us in a new and living from all the essential features of English political institution. The general temper of the times is faithfully reflected in the historical place, and the incidents that affect the common fate of English nation are brought prominently into view. The poet has moreover breathed the breath of life into dead heroes and endowed them with all their natural gifts and characteristics so that they reappear before the reader as distinct and vivid personalities. So these are the things handled in the historical place of Shakespeare. Next we pass on to Shakespeare's use of soliloquy. Soliloquy means nothing but talking to oneself. It is a sort of self-analysis by the introspective method of psychology, although it often refers to certain meters outside the self, and as such it helps to explain the incidents, the thoughts and the secret springs in a play. During the Elizabethan times, soliloquy was regarded as an ordinary but convenient way of imparting information to the audience or of developing the action of the play. Soliloquy owes its origin to the chorus of the Greek tragic plays, which again served as the instrument of certain informations in the form of gist or substance of the main theme of a play. We find soliloquies even in Milton's Samson Agonists and in T.S. Eliot's Murder in the Cathedral. The chorus in the Greek tragedy was a connecting link between the past and the present, between the past and the present. The Greek chorus originally consisted of several persons, but the number was gradually reduced until it came down to one who formed usually one of the main characters in the play. This main character used to deliver a speech informing the audience of certain thing which could not possibly be represented upon the stage. In the modern drama, the chorus has been replaced by an actor who reads out a letter loudly in order to provide information to the listener. It is something like also a talk on the telephone. The real function of a soliloquy is self-analysis and self-revelating to bring on the inner springs of any of the leading characters, particularly the hero of the play. It is mostly the heroes and the villains who generally indulge in soliloquies in the plays of Shakespeare, and mostly in the tragedies, because tragedies are deep with the deeper emotions and the more secret the secret springs of human head and the human heart. Shakespeare's soliloquies are intended, as we have already said, chiefly to explain, to idealize, to inform, and also reveal things which otherwise cannot be revealed either through incident or through dialogue. For illustration of Shakespearean soliloquies, we shall take up and analyze the dramatic significance or some of the well-known soliloquies or Hamlet. In Hamlet, there are altogether 9 soliloquies. 5 of Hamlet himself and 4 of Claudius. In the first soliloquy, Hamlet expresses himself bitter feelings against the whole race of womanhood in general. He expresses his bitter feelings against the treachery of a brother against another brother. These feelings make Hamlet a cynic and a pessimist, a hater of mankind, womanhood, and life itself. This soliloquy reveals at least some of the secret springs of Hamlet's character, such as his sensitiveness, his morbid temperament, his haste in drawing conclusions, and last of all, his habit of reflection and every step whenever his mind or heart happens to be slightly disturbed by any incident or human action. Some critics believe that the first soliloquy of Hamlet is just like a shadow of the coming tragedy of Hamlet's life and career. In the second soliloquy of Hamlet, we can find a clue to his seeming madness, which has been taken by certain scholars as revealed madness. When the ghost discloses the real secrets of the murder of Hamlet's father, Hamlet decides to bend all his energies to the taking of revenge upon his father's murderer, and for this purpose he has to put on the mask of madness in order to mislead the world, just as Claudius looks cheerful, kind and friendly in spite of being a villain at heart. In this soliloquy, Hamlet appears to be a man of action, although we find that all his fiery and sentimental words gradually die into the inaction and mere speculation which become an obsession with Hamlet afterwards in the play, or rather which is an ingrained habit of mind and character. In the third soliloquy, we find Hamlet more determined for the action of revenge against his father's dramatic importance, because on the one hand, it prepares Hamlet for action, while on the other hand, it reveals the rational and cool-headed mind of Hamlet, because he wants to test the truth of the revelations made by the ghost by putting Claudius to the acid test of the mouse trap, which Hamlet lays by enacting a play within the play, namely the murder of Gansala. This soliloquy distinguishes Hamlet from other characters in the play in mind, in heart, in understanding, in judgment, and even in the methods of action. The fourth soliloquy is the most famous soliloquy of Hamlet. because it is the most philosophic of all his salilokis, because from this saliloki the critics have drawn the conclusion that Hamlet is by nature speculative and hence he can never be a man of action. This speculative nature of Hamlet is the real cause of his tragedy. This soliloquy also confirms the ingrained habit of Hamlet's mind, namely his pessimism, his cynicism, his morbidity, and even the beginning of his insanity, although Hamlet is not really a mad, but then one who continually puts on the mask of madness is very likely to go really mad. And besides, pessimism, cynicism, extreme idealism, dreaminess, all are symptoms of some kind of insanity. But the peculiar nature of Hamlet is a dramatic necessity, because otherwise the play would have ended just where it began, or just after the ghost had revealed the secrets of the murder of the Hamlet's father. So the fifth soliloquy of Hamlet does not throw any newer lights on the character of Hamlet. It is more or less like the third soliloquy, because in both the soliloquies Hamlet is spurred to action by external examples. In the one case, the rehearsal of the play, while in the other case, the marching of Norwegian army against Poland. In the fifth soliloquy, Hamlet distinguishes between a man and a beast, and he discovers himself to be no better than a beast because he has delayed unduly the action of his revenge against the murderer of his father. This last soliloquy is a dramatic necessity for delaying the action of revenge, after which everything is hastened to catastrophe. There are altogether four soliloquies of Claudius in Hamlet, three of which are quite short. These soliloquies help to reveal the nature of Claudius, to explain the various states of his mind, also to hasten the dramatic action of the play. In the first soliloquy, Claudius feels guilty and hot because he has been hiding his real character, or rather his crime of murder, under the mask of sweetness and friendliness. Claudius feels the pinch of his conscience. He regrets, but he again prepares for other murderers act. Hence the world he speaks in this soliloquy become really meaningless. The second soliloquy of Claudius is longest. The soliloquy reflects clearly the sincere repentance of the guilty soul, and then Claudius is afraid only of the penalties in other world and not in this world. His words show that he is a paka villain, because he know that in this world one can escape the penalties of crimes if one possesses money, influence and brain. He is therefore not afraid of man, but God, to whom he prays for pardon. but then he does not feel his heart chastened by prayers, which means that he fails to secure pardon first for forgiveness. Hamlet wants to kill him, but he hesitates to kill him. Would be sending him straight to heaven. That is how this soliloquy of Claudius, namely, that in spite of his repentance, he does not improve his character, because immediately next to his prayers, he conspires with Rosencrantz and Guildenterns in order to send away Hamlet to England for his execution. The third soliloquy reveals Claudius further that he is a treacherous creature, because in his soliloquy he actually conspires with Rosencrantz and Guildenstern to pack off Hamlet in order to get him executed. Further, in this soliloquy, Claudius reveals his shrewdness, because he discovers that Hamlet's madness is not genuine but feigned. This soliloquy held to hasten the dramatic action and also to complicate it further in order to hasten crisis of the play. In the fourth or the last soliloquy, Claudius feels unduly secure about his own safety, although we know that too much of security is mortal's chiefest enemy, because it makes one unguarded and thus brings about his ruin of destruction, just as we find in the play how Hamlet returns from England without the killing of Claudius, the murder of his father, and thus fulfilling the law of retribution or justice. Let us pass on to Shakespeare's use of the supernatural events in his plays. The supernatural covers all those phenomena which cannot be explained by the laws of nature. The ancient poets believed in pagan gods, but with the development of the Christian religion, of poets were restricted to the world of tradition, folklore, and superstition. So far religious supernaturalism was concerned, he was not permitted to give any free play to his imagination, but towards superstition he was permitted to give a free play to his imagination, and also to criticize the object of his imagination according to his artistic talent, or as the literary canons demanded it. During the Elizabethan period, the people of England were strongly believed in witches, ghosts, fairies, demons, monsters, prophecies, dreams, and even in astrology and palmistry. As Shakespeare was a very popular dramatist, he had to cater the common superstitions of the people without personally believing in any of them, and that is why we find in his plays so many other sorts of supernatural agencies that have much to do with the destiny of mankind. But then Shakespeare, unlike other contemporary dramatists or unlike his predecessors, endowed the supernatural elements with some amount of dignity and significance. We find the various supernatural agents playing their varied parts in the plays of Shakespeare, both comedies and tragedies, such as Midsummer Night's Dream, The Tempest, Julius Caesar, Hamlet, Macbeth, and Richard the Third. Shakespeare's attitude towards the supernatural varied with the various stages of life. In his earliest years, he regarded the supernatural beings as most amusing creatures, while in his youth and also in his full manhood, he regarded them as positively evil agents or portents that give a warning to man about his coming peril. But at the last stage of his life, when the realities of life had sufficiently invaded his mind, he became rather rational or philosophical towards the supernatural and believed the same agents or portents as good. But then we cannot, strictly speaking, bring his conception about the supernatural into any watertight compartment of and explain its insignificance as such. Shakespeare used much of supernatural elements in A Midsummer Night's Dream. The fairies give him an opportunity for exercising his imaginative faculty, and besides, fairies used to be associated with weddings, and as this comedy was intended to be performed on the occasion of some marriage, Shakespeare introduced much of the fairy element into it. The supernatural element in this play is meant purely for entertainment purposes, although the love of the fairies and other actions of the fairies in this play serve as a parody of the actions of the grosser human beings. At this early stage of Shakespeare's dramatic career, his early stage of dramatic career, he did not conceive of the supernatural element as any factor governing human destiny, as he conceived it to play its more significant and mysterious part in his tragedies or in the romances in which things happen and human individuals behave in a stranger manner than any reason can possibly explain. Of course, Shakespeare borrowed his supernatural beings mostly from the Greek mythology, but he draped them all in the color of his own imagination, and just as his dramatic expediency demanded. He softened the classical character of the supernatural beings and made them thoroughly English. The chief characteristics of the fairies in A Midsummer Night's Dream is merely to play mischief by interfering mischievous Puck in the least offensive and most entertaining. In spite of all the mischiefs he plays upon other characters in the play, it is striking that Shakespeare maintains a strict mark of distinction between the supernatural creatures and the human characters in Midsummer Night's Dream, because he believes that the supernatural world is governed by quite different laws from those that govern the natural world. this particular point he emphasized most strongly in the greatly influenced the conception of the supernatural of the succeeded writers, either poets or dramatists, and it also helped in finally remotive from the supernatural beings the idea of malice or revenge. Although Shakespeare's great tragedies, the motive of revenge or retribution of closely associated with the supernatural in Hamlet and in Macbeth and in Julius Caesar. The treatment of the supernatural in Hamlet foreshadows the gloom of Macbeth. He has used the ghost in Hamlet as the terrifying against superstitious, particularly about ghosts. He makes the ghost real in order to serve the dramatic purpose. The ghost appears in very strange circumstances, such as the witching time of the night when churchyard yawn and hell itself breathes out contagion to the world. The ghost made to speak only when it is questioned or spoken to it, and it respond only to a scholar, probably because ghosts used to be supported to be superhuman beings, and that is why we find the ghosts of Hamlet's father being questioned by Horatio, the scholar. Ghosts during Shakespeare's time used to appear just before some great human calamity in order to give a warning or to indicate some motive of revenge or the process of retribution for wrong done to some innocent souls. The ghost of Hamlet's father appears before the son in order to inform him about the true murderer of his father, and also to instigate him further to take revenge upon the murderer. There are two types of the ghost, namely subjective and objective. The objective ghost is seen only by one who suffers from mental distraction and who naturally sees hallucination. The hallucination due to an unduly imaginative mind or to guilty consciousness. For example, the ghost of Banquo is seen only by Macbeth, because Macbeth alone suffers from distraction of the brain and is also guilty for the simple reason that it is under the instruction of Macbeth that Banquo is murdered. The consciousness of the guilt of Duncan's father also further lends a color to the imaginative mind or the distracted brain of Macbeth. And that is why neither Lady Macbeth nor any character in the play sees the ghost of Banquo. In Hamlet, however, the ghost does not appear as the result of anybody's guilty consciousness, although it should have appeared before Gertrude and Claudius, because they are the really guilty souls who are responsible for the murder of Hamlet's father. But then Shakespeare makes the ghost in Hamlet purposely objective in order to hear some dramatic effect upon the audience. In Julius Caesar, the ghost is again subjective because it appears only before Brutus, who is one of the leading conspirators of Caesar. in order to revenge whose death the ghost appears twice before Brutus. The supernatural in Macbeth is probably of the greatest significance because it is not only has the greatest dramatic effect upon the audience, but it also reflects the gloomiest or most tragic state of Shakespeare's own mind when he composed the play. In the other tragedies, the supernatural element does not signify so much of the pessimistic attitude of the dramatist's mind as it does in Macbeth. Prospero in The Tempest possesses many supernatural powers, but he does not exercise any of them with malice or with any revengeful spirit. Ariel represents the finer spirits of the air, while Caliban represents the grosser element of the earth. While comparing Ariel and Caliban, Coleridge remarks, "Nothing was ever more finely conceived than this contrast between the maternal and the spiritual, the gross and the delicate." So this is it, the Shakespearean plays, usage of supernatural events in his plays, and usage of soliloquies, and the historical place.